Would like to now introduce Rohit Prajapati, who is also a longtime friend of AID. He most recently joined us in the Portland Conference in 2018. He's an engineer by training. He has been an activist since his college days, engaging with trade unions, environment, water pollution, occupational health, organic farming, forest, and indigenous people, as well as defense of civil liberties, peace, and justice. He's a one-man AID. He is a co-founder and member of Paryavaran Suraksha Samiti, National Secretary of the People's Union for Civil Liberties. He's part of the anti-nuclear movement in India and has also been involved with the Narmada Bachao Andolan and People's Commission on Shrinking Democratic Space. Like many activists during this period, Rohit is engaged in online teaching and lecturing every day and has personally given me hope that there will be a light at the end of this tunnel. So Rohit, we're really glad that you could spare some time to share with us your observations and why you think there is still cause for hope.
I'm more going to focus on workers from informal sector and also going to refer a little bit with reference to if you are from minority community and belong to informal sector. Let me begin with one summarized statement from migrants, because I'm talking to almost every day with the migrants in and around Gujarat. So in last 2 days, what they want to tell us. I'm just trying to articulate their grievances. They say betrayed by governments, industries are seeing the pills of urban life and are in the mode of ab lot chale, leading to reverse migration at a rapid rate. We don't see us coming back to the cities, industrial clusters for some time. Ab hum lot chale. If you just look at the last 2 days of India, where government decided ad hocly, not well planned, I don't know in what context, how they decide number of things during lockdowns, that they will allow a migrant worker to move from one state to other state. And also there are issues of interstate migration in number of states. If you just look at the train traveling, just one example, that they were asked to pay for that travel, plus 50 rupees extra. So you can imagine that if at this stage the workers are asked to pay the travel, you can imagine what benefit or what relief would have been given to them when they were at the work site. This is one rude example which conveys lots of issues to the society in general. That is one I want to make a point. If you just look at COVID-19 has unveiled many realization. If I am not mistaken, it is first time in the Indian history, while talking to number of people on the webinar and also WhatsApp calls, it is first time in the Indian history where workers of informal sector and migrant workers are able to prove their importance in capitalist industrial setup. They have made the Indian state governments, bourgeois economists, and industrialists collectively realize and internalize that the so-called marginalized section of society has played and are playing the crucial role of backbone of Indian industry, their profits, Indian GDP, and its economic, in spite their hand-to-mouth miserable condition. Why I'm saying so, if you just look at debates in the TV now, from last 2 days, including the spokesperson of BJP, are worried about migrant worker going back to their state. They are too much worried about industry. And even if you just look at various industrial associations and presidents debating and making point that why at this point government is trying to allowing workers to move from our work site where we are planning to start the industry. That itself raised very fundamental issue about the role which informal sector worker and particularly migrant workers are playing in the industry, which is generally theoretically known, which generally talks about it, but first time I had seen people realizing it, and that's very crucial. The one of the major thing which I found while talking to the workers almost like every day during the night time and during the afternoon time, that there were three things happening. which I want to just put on record. I'm not talking about much about the condition because that you can read. And you can also go through my article on lockdown, how lockdown was thought of and how unplanned it is and it was, and how extension is ad hoc and why ad hocism happened, what happened to number of people, including the worker. There are three things happening. First time I had seen, because I'm working on the industrial pollution issue and also trade unionists. So I had first time seen the informal sector worker and particularly migrant worker are collectively discussing something about their life. They might have discussed while sitting at home as part of one state, but first time I had seen people are able to relate each other issue and that trying to articulate and that trying to discuss their common issue and realizing the common issue. That is one I had found during the discussion with them. Second, I had seen that you will find in various industrial clusters where there is a conflict between the villagers and the migrant workers, because many time on the issue of livelihood, the villagers are opposing industries, not allowing them to come, or you will find constant conflict between the industrial worker and the industry, which ultimately result into many times between the informal sector worker, particularly migrant worker and the community. Here, first time, I had seen people are able to understand each other issues, because many places in Gujarat, we were able to manage to help the migrant worker with the help of the villagers in the beginning. And then we made a point that villagers are able to help them and also to see that not just in terms of getting their rights, because villagers themselves are in poor condition, to see that they get implement the so-called government promises. So first time they were able to understand why villagers are opposing the industry in what context and why they are saying that more jobs should be given to the local people. Same way, villagers also realize that when migrant workers are used by the industry to fight back the villagers, what are the grievances of these migrant workers? And I had seen while discussing with them number of time, and at least 2 days before when migrant worker decided that they really want to go, but ab lot chale. That time I had seen that the dialogue between villagers and the worker, where they were able to relate their common issue, and they found that they have less conflict than many commons, which they need to fight together. That's one of the crucial aspect which I strongly feel that it is happening on the ground. One more thing I want to make a point that it is difficult time only just to provide relief, because we ourselves has realized that we were able to mobilize resources from the local villagers in terms of grains and other support, and also for crowdfunding. We thought that we will not able to our main focus was to bring to see that how various government schemes are implemented. That is one. And now let's come to quickly 2-3 points about the workers issue in particular, that there are three things which are completely ignored by the state, also missing in the debate. And I'm really want to say sorry for the trade union. They also had not brought in front, but there are almost like 3 to 4 crore ESI worker, those who are registered under employee state insurance schemes, where ultimately this money is collected from the workers. And the share which comes from the so-called industrialist, which is also a share of the workers, and that corpus is, if you just look at the figure of, I'm just want to refer the 2018, it's about 84,000 crore. If I estimate now, the money will be about more than 90,000 crore. This money is lying. This money is basically used for the social security in terms of the health. And when you are very sick, then you get the 50% wages while sitting at the home. I'm really worried why this money has not been thought to use for the workers at all, and why it is not in a debate at all. And this money is a huge amount. It's basically a not state money, government money. It's basically money collected by workers themselves under ESI scheme. And I know that it will only applicable to the registered worker, those who are ESI member, those who are on record of the factories, but this money is lying there very much, which is completely ignored how to use that money. And government has no plan for this money. If you just look at the government website and look at what is their plan, it's unused money lying there. So that is one I want to just bring to notice. And also about the construction worker, Even Sitar, the finance minister say that it's a 31,000 crore money for the construction worker. This money is also lying. And the crucial point which I want to mention by giving this two figure and to conclude that the government has money. I'm telling you about the 23rd April 2020 meetings of the Environment Ministries Committee, where they discussed the Central Vista project, which was announced long back to reconstruct the parliament and also to have a whole plan to play a major mischief with the landscape of the whole area by violating environment laws. And on 19th of March, the announcement of lockdown happened. On 20th of March, 20 crores sanctioned. That reports come to the newspaper. I'm not exactly knowing about the 20,000 crore figure come from what. But this project has been cleared, environment clears in this crisis, on 23rd April 2020 meeting. This clearly indicates that government has money and priority both, and they absolutely ignoring the informal sector worker. And the last point, I would just want to make a point that it's a time for three things. It's time to facilitate, to help the informal sector and migrant workers to articulate their viewpoint grievances in a very organized way. We should help them to theorize it. We should help them to legalize how to put legally those things to, and we should help them to look for a longer term. And the last point, I want to just make a point that basically many workers are telling us that they don't want to come back also. And on the other side, the industries are too much worried about if this informal sector workers will not come back, how they are going to run the industry. So unfortunately, the reality is worst on the ground. And if you just look at the media report of many channels, they are completely ignoring this. And person like me who is staying in a Muslim majority area, I'm just now not able to reach my house. I'm sitting somewhere else. The situation is worst because there you will have a combination of two things. One is you are poor. Second is you, if you are from the migrant worker from other state, and third is Muslim. This three combination is very terrible. And I myself is not able to sleep many nights while talking to them every day in the night.